Yes, thank you very much. I would like to say thank you to all organizers, and particularly for Laura, who make a lot of effort to organize my trip here and my stay here. This is a great opportunity for me to tell you about some research we are doing right now in the Preventive Conservation Group in the Getty Conservation Institute. And I will talk about micromechanics of paints, like historic and modern paints. And what we were trying to do in the Getty Institute right now, and I think that almost every preventive conservation group is trying to do all over the world, is to find some knowledge-based strategies for preservation of museum collections. And we realized that to do that in the scientific way and in a responsible way, we need to understand the damage processes. And the damage processes are including the chemical, biological, and mechanical degradation. And in many, many cases, actually in most of the cases, the mechanical changes are results of the chemical and biological. And if we understand the mechanical changes of the materials, we would be able, as it was presented very comprehensively by Marion Mecklenburg, to model the behavior of objects during the transportation and different types of treatments, also storage and display conditions. So the thing is that it's well understood that people are doing the characterization of materials. I'm showing here the one of my favorite graphs from Marion's work, showing the different behavior of different paints after different times of exposure to environmental conditions. And the fact is that using those kind of information, we can use them to model the behavior of the complex systems as a multi-layer systems, such as a panel or canvas paintings. The problem, though, is that the making such a test require macroscopic samples, and those tests are destructive, which means that in our field we cannot really work with the original materials taken from the objects, because it would require destroying them in a kind of a massive way. So it's completely unethical and impossible. So what we do, we are making tests on samples mimicking historic materials. So we are preparing sample of the similar composition and manufacturing technology, which are sometimes subjected to aging, sometimes not, depending on the type of study we would like to do. And this is a very effective way of doing the things and helps us understand the systems. But you have to remember that the quality of the modeling we are doing, any predictive model, critically depends on the quality of the data we are putting into the model. So it is extremely interesting for us to know the properties of original historic materials and possible to see how the mock-ups we are preparing correspond to the original materials. And if you would like to do that, we decide that the only way to do that is to really look at the microscale and try to work with the size of the sample which are available in our field. And here is my introduction to micro and nano mechanics. So a few years ago, we decided to invest in the micro and nano indentation. And this is machine we are using for characterization of the sample. I will tell about it a little more later. The key thing is that the small scale of the probes allows to characterize sub-millimeter objects in virtually non-destructive way, which is exactly the type of samples we've got from original paintings. And we can do that in the different temperature and humidity conditions. So what exactly this machine is doing? This is actually the well-established method of working with some microelectronics and biological materials in the engineering field. And what we can do with that is to use this extremely small probe to push into the material, and we can measure the force and the deformation during such a process. So you see on this graph the relation between applied load and induced deformation. And when we push the probe into the material, we've got combination of a plastic and elastic deformation, because the probe is sharp, so we always have a plastic forces in in the tip of the probe. Then what we can observe is when we hold the load, we can observe the creep of the material if the, if there is a time dependency in this material, but in the paints typically is the case. And then we can unload the probe, and during unloading we only observe the elastic behavior. So from this part of the curve we can calculate the stiffness or Young modulus of the materials, if you will. And we can do a lot of different analysis, finding the elastic modulus, elastic plastic energy ratio, creep, storage loss modulus if we do dynamic indentation. And also, it requires a little different types of analysis, but also we can find hardness and fracture toughness of the material. And I would like to now, because this is, I understand, kind of an abstract presentation of the capability of the technique, so I would like to show you the two case studies, two situations in which we apply the nano indentation for understanding materials and what was the results of that. So the first case would be the using a nano indentation for modern oil paints to decide about the display conditions and cleaning processes, and the second case is the work on cross-sectional samples for the commercial acrylic paint. So let's focus on the first case. This is the work we did together with the Cecil Krop Andersson from the Royal Danish Academy of Fine Arts, and this work was done within the CIMO project cleaning of modern oil paints. What we try to do is to look how the different conditions influence the paints which can be treated in a different way. So in this case, you see how the samples looks like. They are not really micro samples. They are kind of big samples, but still very difficult to work with classical methods, because those are in casted on the mylar as a very thin films, and in the room conditions, they are very brittle. So removing them, installing in some testing machine is a kind of a complicated process. So what we did with that, we just took some small samples of those paints, installed on the glass slides, and tried to use nano indentation to characterize their properties. And we had to develop some different method or the modification of the method for working with those paints, because paints, especially in high humidity, as you know, are very time dependent, are very flexible, can be flexible, but also very time dependent. So what we did, we add to this typical loading and loading scheme also the dynamic variations of the force. So in this way, we have a combination of the static or the quasi-static and dynamic indentation, and we can measure dynamic properties of these paints. And then we try to choose the parameters of the test in such a way to obtain result which are very weakly dependent on the parameters of the test. And the most important thing is that we had to go pretty deep into the material to have a stable results, which in our case mean 6 micrometers. 6 micrometers might not seem to be very deep. However, from the nano indentation process is a really big deformation. So what we really do is a dynamic micro indentation with nano resolution. So we did all our tests in the different humidity conditions. So what we tried to do was we tried to obtain this 6 micrometer depth indentation in different humidities. And as you see, to obtain this depth of indentation, we need to use a very different force, which shows clearly that paint become softer and softer when we go to higher humidities. And this test was done on the Winsor Newton Ultramarine Blue paint. So relative humidity and applied load are inversely proportional. This is not surprising. If you look at the change of the mass of the sample, we see, of course, increase of the mass with increasing humidity, which means just absorption of the paint. So during the absorption of this paint, we observe also that it becomes softer. And maybe better way to show that is to look at the reduced storage modulus, which actually represents the fast young modulus of this paint. And what you can see here is this dramatic change of modulus at about 65-70 percent relative humidity. So in this region, paint is going through some transition from the brittle to really low stiffness state. And as a proof of that, we can observe also the indentation marks. So under the microscope, we can see what is happening, how this paint behaves. And you see that the same force used in 50% relative humidity and in 70% relative humidity results in very different indents, which means that this paint is definitely much, much softer in a high humidity. And it's not only softer, it's, I would say, more viscous. If we look then at the tan delta, which informs us directly about viscosity of the paint, we again see the same, the transition in the same region, of course, and paint in 80% relative humidity is almost liquid in comparison to 35% relative humidity, in which the indent has got a very well-defined shape. So what we know from that, we can learn how the properties of the material are changing depending on the humidity, so we may make some decision about the storage or display conditions for this paint and understand what kind of a humidity or temperature may result in those dramatic changes of the paints. There is more we can do about that. So this is the another study in which we try to focus on the cleaning, and as a simulation of the cleaning, we decide to immerse the yellow ochre paints into the heptane. Of course, it's not like a proper cleaning process. We never suggest to immerse paintings in the heptane. But you know, since we try to just understand what are the consequences of the interaction between the solvent and the paint, this is just a good simulation procedure. So, and on the left side, you see a result. This is probably the most boring results you were ever seen in your life. It's just before and after the surface behave exactly the same. So we've got the same stiffness and no any change observed. But we wanted so much to see some change that we also do this thing, like, and then we indent the underside of the paint. And this is interesting because the underside behaves differently than the top side, because top side is obviously exposed to environmental conditions, so there are some changes of the properties. And underside, even before immersion, has got almost two times higher modulus, and after immersion, even higher. What we can learn from that is that we have to think about the cleaning process in such a way that even if we don't have any changes of the properties on the surface, there may be some changes of properties in the bulk of the material. So having this kind of information may inform us about the time of interaction between the solvent and the material, for example. So from this case study, I can say that nanoindentation allows us to measure properties of a paint film as a function of temperature and relative humidity and learn about the change of the mechanical properties in different conditions. We can trace alternation in mechanical properties of oil paints resulting from water sorption and immersion. And we can distinguish between the surface properties and the bulk properties, which can inform some conservation practice potentially. The second case study I would like to show is the mechanical characterization of cross-sectional paint sample. And those are extremely interesting for us because cross-sectional samples of paints are commonly available. Like conservators, as you know, as we know, as everybody knows, are taking cross-sectional sample for mostly for optical analysis, for some chemical analysis, never for mechanical analysis, but maybe it is going to change. Because we can use potentially the same samples which are used for optical analysis for mechanical testing, because we need only such a small amount of material to perform the test. And if we can do that, this will be kind of like a dream, because we would be able to look at the probabilistic distribution of the materials coming from the different artists, different region, different age, and then would be able to create the information about requirements of the painting from the different collections and their the conditions which are needed for their preservation. And when I think about like working with particular artists, like a Picasso, for example, this would be like a dream work to understand what particular materials he used for his painting are behaving right now. So we decided to work with that to understand how we can characterize those very small cross-sectional sample. And instead of starting with existing sample, we decided to create our own first to better understand the process and understand the results we obtain. So we decided to work with titanium white acrylic-based paint, which is very, very flexible and time-dependent, so difficult material to work with, but very easy to prepare and very easy to embed. So we prepare the samples with different sizes, and we are particularly interested in this type of a cross-sectional small sleeve of paint embedded into resin. And we used the liquid resin, which is light curing. So the process of embedding is very fast, and then we can hand polish the surface. And the tests we make were made in such a way that we created the matrix of indents all over this sample, just to be able to understand what are the properties of the material in the relation to the interface between the resin and the paint sample. And what we observe is a kind of disturbing thing, because depending on the size of the sample and its shape, we sometimes have the situation when on the edge between the resin and the paint, we don't really see significant change on modulus. So value of measured reduced modulus is strongly affected by proximity of a paint-resin interface. And this is interesting, and it's worth to investigate, so we investigated it, of course. So what you see here is the same sample, but with a lot of beautiful indents we made on the surface. So this is a paint side, this is a resin side, and there are effects we can call the structural compliance, which is influencing measured properties of the material. So on the resin side, when we push into the resin close to the proximity with the paint, what we do, we effectively pull the paint toward the indenter. And because paint is soft, it's easier to push into because it's easy to bend the paint. So what we expect the modulus measured close to the interface of the resin to be lower than the modulus of the resin itself. On the paint, it's opposite. When we are close to the interface, we have to pull the resin, which is stiff, so the measured modulus should be higher. And what we observe? We observe exactly this kind of effect. So modulus of the resin close to interface is changing, going down, and the paint going up. But the problem is that this is a very big value. We have this change of the modulus of the paint side, which is different than the modulus of the free film over the 100 micrometers. And this is a very big value, and it cannot be explained really by the structural compliance of the sample. So what we were thinking about, it's not only the structural compliance, but also there is infiltration of the resin into the paint. So if there is infiltration of the resin into the paint close to the interface is actually stiffer. So if this is the case, what we need to do, we need really to find the embedding material which is not going to infiltrate into the sample. And there are such materials. So instead of using the liquid liquid resin, which has got a large infiltration but low stiffness, we decide to go for the paste form, which is nice because it's not infiltrating, but has got a very high modulus. So now we were kind of avoiding the problem of infiltration, but we are enhancing the problem of structural compliance. And you can see here, I will explain what is happening here. So we make this test again on the paint close to the interface with resin, which now is this very stiff resin, the paste tape type resin. And what we found, looking at the value of stiffness in function of depth of penetration, we found that this is not a straight line, and it should be a straight line, because the stiffness should linearly depend on the depth of the penetration. It is not, because there is significant compliance we are measuring all over this sample. But we can correct that if we assume, we make two assumptions. If we assume that structural compliance does not depend on penetration depth and modulus of the material is constant over constant with depth, we can actually find the structural compliance value which makes this graph linear. And then we can find this value for each distance from the interface. And if we use this correction for our data, we've got this kind of results. This is our cross-sectional sample from the 0 to 150 micrometers. And you see the value of modulus in the resin is 15 gigapascal, and the value of paint in between 1 and 2 gigapascal. And maybe I show that. This transition is super steep because we've got the small value at the distance of, let's say, 15 micrometers. And before, if you remember, we had the curve which is going up to 100 micrometers. So we were able to fight with the problem of structural compliance and the infiltration in this way. And having this result, now if I change the scale here, you can see that we not only observe like a very reasonable value of modulus of the paint, but also we have some distribution of the modulus across the paint film, which shows that the paint and at the surface and on the bottom has got a little different properties, which is very interesting because we can now think about the drying process and maybe try to understand how the film was formed. And then if we would like to make a modeling of the cracking behavior of the paint, we can possibly introduce this difference of the stiffness on the very skin of the paint and the bulk of the paint inside. So choice of embedding material allow to control infiltration and difference of stiffness between the paint and the resin, and structural compliance can be corrected to obtain true paint properties. And at this point, you may think that it's a little silly what I show you, because I show you first what I would like to do, then I show you a problem which you were not aware of, and then I show you that I can solve this problem, so we are again at the very beginning of the story. But it's not actually true, because what I try to say is that we are not so free in choosing the cross-sectional sample for our test. If you would like to have reasonable results and understand true properties of a paint, we have to practically prepare those cross-sections by ourselves to understand well the preparation process. And then we can perform the tests which are meaningful. So going to the very last conclusions, I wanted to show you that nano-indentation technique allows us to measure properties of a paint and is very sensitive to alternation induced by treatment or exposure to particular conditions. It can be done in a very small scale and it has got a very high spatial resolution. On the basis of those tests, we can compare mockups with original materials. This is important for us to strengthen all the predictive models we can have. And we can understand how properties of historic paints depends on the environmental conditions very directly, and we can possibly inform some conservation strategies. And on the very bottom, with a little smaller print, is my disclaimer. We have to work on specific measuring protocols, taking into consideration properties of analyzed materials and method of sample preparation that needs to be elaborated for particular materials. And at this point, I would like to thank you very much. I would like to thank Managing Collection Environment Initiative, which is the project I'm working in, and also those three people which are absolutely crucial to do this work, Naoki Fujisawa, Ashley Freeman, and Vincent Beltran. Thank you very much.